Lord, we bless you for the way that your Spirit is moving in Revelation. And Lord, how it, your Spirit orchestrates and brings up things for your pleasure. For your pleasure. And Lord, we want to stay with that. It's so easy for us to start shifting our focus to each other or something else. And this is all about you. This is all about you. It may be the widow's mite. It may be the rich young ruler's wealth. It runs the whole gauntlet, but it's all for you. Yes. And we just submit this time now that you would breathe and just eliminate anything that's not of you. In Jesus' name. Okay, well, y'all right here? Okay. We just want the presence, right? We just, I mean, otherwise, stand up, sit down, hear some great intellectual word, go home and be unchanged. And anyway, we don't want that. We want you to encounter the King, and if that happens through something that happens here outside, spontaneous, it's just, that's why we don't want you to feel relegated to a chair. Sit down, stand up, raise your hands, don't. Just you and Jesus, right? Okay. So, I wanted to kind of go through this fairly succinctly. I don't know how well I can do, but you are here. You ever find one of those on a map? Isn't that kind of a relief? Oh, okay, I thought I was lost, right? Have you had that, right? You're in a mall going, where the heck am I, right? Some of these big places. You are here. So we always want to do that, and we do that in time, but I want to just back up. I want to pull some things I did from when I taught at New Covenant a while ago, just as an illustration, right? For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. Leave, cleave, become one. And an actual marriage goes through this process ongoing, right? It's not a one-time event. It's something you're constantly cycling through. There's always more things that you got to leave about the old stuff, right? Any of you married here? Okay, right? If you there's always old stuff. I can't believe you still do that. You know, you're, okay. That's actually, you got to be careful with those phrases because that them can be fighting words. But it's true, right? We drag the old baggage along. We got to leave it. And then there's that cleaving. And that process allows us to become one. And there's a deeper involvement each time. It's another layer, it's another layer, it's another layer. And, you know, this was written, I think, in alignment for us because we honor God's calendar. And he set up three major appointment times. These are my appointed times. Appointed Feast of the Lord, which you are to proclaim. And you know what they are. Three times a year when all your men must appear before me at the place he chooses. First month, third month, seventh month. Passover, Pentecost, and Tabernacles. It's not complicated, right? I am doing this so fast. I'm having to do some of this because we have new people come onto the web and they have no clue who we are, what we do. So I'm trying to just, you know. But I want to refresh this because we're about to come around the corner in towards Passover. You got to know you are here. And we're leading up to that because you've got Passover, of course, that's that first mark. That's leading to Pentecost and Tabernacles. And the actual relationship is supposed to grow each year that we go through these. Not legalistically, but you just consider them appointment times where you sit down the first time and go, okay, God, what do I need to leave? What parts of the old are still clinging on that I got to deal with, right? It's an onion, folks. If you think you got it all left, then we'll pray off denial and self-deception. And maybe it'll get a chance for you to see then what else you're carrying, right? Okay. And then the cleaving comes because Pentecost really is about a wedding ceremony. It's a negotiated wedding contract that Moses does. And it is by the Spirit that comes down. And he is that seal. He is that ring that seals and it writes it on our heart. The marriage contract goes from being written on stone to being written in our hearts. And then the tabernacles is that pursuit of deeper, deeper oneness with him. There's the blood that breaks us out of Egypt, but there's the blood that we need that keeps us constantly before the presence of God, right? We go boldly before him because the blood of Jesus cleanses our conscience and keeps us moving. So we do all that, and so we understand that Paul says, for this reason, a man shall leave his father, mother, and cleave to his wife to become flesh. Profound mystery. I'm talking about Christ and the ecclesia. And I'd say the ecclesia because it's translated in the King James as church, but that's too often an institution, right? Or a building. The ecclesia are those who are called out to go forward. And so that's the dynamic. And so the bride, I don't know if you can see that the lion is back in there, the Lion of Judah. You can see him better out there, the print that the Lanes gave it to us. But too often the bride's like this, right? And if you've ever seen the movie The Runaway Bride, although most of the time it's more like The Runaway Wife, right? Go to the altar, get the suit, I'm out of here. And it's because the bride's never done the full leaving, doesn't really want to do the cleaving, and certainly doesn't want to become one. There's a whole lot more involved in that. But we're still at a time when we're getting to Passover, and so we're at the lead up here. And so how easy is it to leave? How easy is it to leave? You're going to go, well, what? Who? Exactly, right? How easy is it to leave something that you're really accustomed to? Why? Habits have been formed. Sorry, you all talking at one time. Give me one at a, what?
That's where your heart is.
That's where your heart is. Yeah, you just, you what?
You don't leave your heart.
You don't leave your heart. Yeah, so it's just. Okay. Well, and I'm not just talking about now a spouse, but I'm talking about when you got to leave. Let's talk about leaving Egypt, talking about leaving something where you've gotten very comfortable. How long had Israel been in Egypt? 430 years, right? Long time, 10 generations worth, right? Over and over and over again. You smell those leeks and onions? Stew tonight. Hot bread. Cold spring water. You know, the Nile's looking pretty good, right? The Nile was the source of virtually all life and commerce in Egypt, right? It was so honored and worshipped because of what it did. And when it overflowed its banks once a year, it deposited fresh silt around. It brought life to otherwise that desert area. You're used to these things, right? My daddy's 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 dad was a slave and servant under your daddy's dad's taskmaster, right? I mean, this thing just goes on. And so you don't beat me. I work relatively hard for you, right? This is how it works. Okay? So it's hard. And what does it take to shift? What does it take to break and change?
Grace.
What?
Grace.
Grace, yeah.
But, a big mind change.
Pardon me?
A mind change.
A mind change, yeah. Good. Courage, what?
Denying the self.
You guys are getting all very spiritual here. Just, pardon me?
A kick in the butt.
Uncomfortable situations. Okay, what was that?
A kick in the butt.
A kick in the butt, thank you. Took my wife to come up with some of that there. Willpower, okay, yeah. Something to stir it on, because familiarity breeds what?
Contentment.
Yeah, it also just breeds staying put. Right? Years ago, I've told you this before. I don't know if they still follow it. They probably do. But in television programming, back in the days before remotes, the networks followed an idea about low objectionable programming. If you had a big hit like Happy Days, you didn't remember that, some of you? You didn't have to put on a good show afterwards. You just had to be not objectionable. Because if it wasn't objectionable, people wouldn't get up to turn the channel. They'd just sit there and watch it, and suddenly it would become popular, right? Because we're comfortable, we're settled. Getting up, if it's objectionable, oh my, then somebody gets up and actually changes the channel. Okay. So, but what else does it take? It's this. This is Newton's first law. A body at rest will remain at rest unless acted upon by an outside force. That is a law. Not only of the physical universe, but of us emotionally and spiritually and everything else, right? A body at rest, you tend to be just, right? You're going to sit there. So what we're getting to is that there's a repetitive progression that I see here. Yeah, because it all has to do with a jolt. I think we all need a jolt to get changed. Anybody here agree? Okay. How many can change with small jolts? Okay.
I thought that said Joel.
Okay.
Joel and T. She's my jolter.
Joel, there you go. Yeah. Some of you are married to your jolt. Some of you have kids who are jolts or relatives are jolts. I'm your jolt. So anyway, here's where this goes. A jolt leads to joy, which leads to the journey, which leads to joining, which leads to a Jordan, which will require yet another jolt. How about that? So where I'm going here is that there was a jolt required in Egypt. There was a jolt required in Jerusalem, just so we're clear, because this follows in each time period. It happens in Egypt. It happens in Jerusalem. Okay? In the same time of Passover, and it's happening now. There's a buildup of pressures. There's a jolt that comes. That leads to a joy and a freedom, right? That leads to a journey, which leads to joining. That's the next stage. It's not just about getting free. Leave, cleave, becoming one. And then that's going to take you to a Jordan. A Jordan is that barrier that leads to more. But you got to be willing to cross over that too. But we know how well that went, right? Which is where typically the rest of the church often gets stuck. Well, that's just when I die. No, that's here and now, because there's a battle to fight. When you die, there's no more battle over there. You got to wage war to take that. You get this coming around? So a jolt leads to joy, a journey, joining, and Jordan, and that loops back around. Yeah, you got it? I'm sorry, I'm just a model guy. I like models. So we're not only to be okay with the jolt, but we have to agree with the buildup to the jolt to get there. That's the hard part. Some of you, there's a buildup to a jolt coming. Some of you are in it. Some of you are anticipating it. Some of you had it done to you. Some of you are trying to find it. There's got to be a live wire here somewhere. Let me grab onto it. Some of you are listening on the web because you're trying to find it. There's a hunger for more. I need the jolt. Some of you are stuck because there's no jolt that's come along. Because fat and happy is the way we will stay. As long as there's not objectionable programming in something in government or something in the school or something in your church, you will just stay there and, okay, well, I just hope something gets better.
When you said that they were content and what were in Egypt, then I said, along comes Moses.
Yes, yes. Here he comes. The jolt is coming, right? You go good so far? You tracking? Because see, we're leading up to that Passover. So the question is, what are the pressures that we're building? And so a couple of weeks ago, I talked about what's holding you back. But part of the thing that happens is there is a holdback bar. This carrier is moving. It's ready to launch. You see the plane that's on deck there? That's a jet blast door that's there. It's going to keep when that goes to full military power from that, just washing somebody right over the side because of the backwash from it. And in the front of that, you see this long strip that's there. There is a laser on here somewhere, but I'm not sure where it is. Oh, well, I don't want to mess something up. Okay. So there somewhere. Anyway, so that long strip you see right in front of the plane, right, that is where the catapult is coming. And inside there, the jolt's going to let it go on a 300-foot runway. It's going to go from 0 to 160 in 2 seconds, and it's going to take off. And that pilot is going to experience about 2.5 G-forces being thrust back. You think there's a jolt there? Do you think there's a little joy once I get airborne? But the reality is that we don't get airborne just to go and have a flight. There's a purpose now. There's a mission. There's an assignment. There's a target out there waiting. There's something to do. Okay? Our challenge is often, you know, we get somebody launched and then we just think they're on their own. They're just kind of out there having, hey, isn't this great? I get to fly. And guys are like, whoa, I've got stuff to do here. There's more joy still. Don't just, no, come on, where are you going? Stay in touch. So this thing is now turned into the wind. It builds up full speed. They charge two forces that are going, okay? One, that goes to full military throttle. That's not full fighting speed. They can go with afterburners and get to supersonic. But this is full throttle. Look at the way that thing is just, can you feel it? Because that thrust is throwing back that way, and equal and opposite reaction, right? Newton's law coming in there. Because that's pushing back at the planes, wanting to go. And you see right underneath the wheels there, there's a holdback bar, this one bar that's holding it there. Now, meanwhile, underneath there is this catapult that's drawing all this energy from steam generators, and that's pulling it off the nuclear reactor, and it's building pressure, and it's up and up and up and up and up. And this thing is probably about 45 to 50,000 pounds of steel. And if this plane didn't have that catapult and tried to just take off, it would never make it. It would dribble off the edge. And if that plane wasn't at full throttle and they hit the catapult, it would break the front landing gear right off the plane. Just snap it off. And the plane wouldn't go anywhere. It has to have both this internal force that's driving it with full throttle and this external. And it all links to this. Now the Lord said to Moses, I will bring one more plague on Pharaoh and on Egypt. After that, he will let you go from here. And when he does, he will drive you out completely. So God stirs up that force within, fueling you and saying, throttle, throttle, throttle. But there's a holdback bar that builds the tension until he creates the right dynamic outside. And you have to understand, this goes on in Egypt, this goes on all around Jesus. And I need you to be reading, when you're reading the Gospels leading up to this, you need to see all the factors that are playing out and the pressure that's building, building, building. Because your life is mirroring this right now. Many of you. There's a hunger inside. It's like, right? And there's external things. Some of those have triggered for you. Some have not. Some are waiting. Some you're like going, I don't think any of that's true. I'm sorry. Maybe it's not, but I suspect it is, and you don't know it, so your jolt might be a little bit better. You want to be at full throttle, because if that catapult goes to fling you out and you're not, then you're just going to get broken apart. You good? Mm-hmm. Everybody's tracking this, right? Okay. Except Ronnie. Things never change for Ronnie. So always the same, you know. Been there, done. Not true at all. Ronnie's in. He knows the strange ways of God. So that holdback bar is a device that God will have for just the right time. And the crazy story in Exodus, if you were having to live through it, is to see all this force and all this thing building, 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 and you're going, okay, wait a minute, why did there have to be 10 plagues? Why did there have to be any? Couldn't he just come at the beginning, do the first one last? Just strike down Pharaoh's kid. That amount has sprung us out, right? What's with all the time? Any idea how long the plagues probably took? Estimates are from a minimal of like 40 days. People like the 40 because 40, you know, works a lot. But it's entirely probable because of other things I won't go into that it actually was months and months, maybe like 11 months. So Moses comes, the deliverer comes, right? Shows you these really cool signs and you're like, okay, I'll pack tomorrow. And instead, it just gets worse. You have hope in your heart. Your bags are packed. But let's make a deal is going on. Okay? You good? Now, I want to give you another context because one of the things I watch for is I watch the prophetic words that are being released by some of the major people. And there's certain key prophets that I will listen to specifically, but I try to keep a broad sense because God does nothing without telling his servants the prophets, right? He's still doing that. Doug Addison released this word, I think it was today, when he said, remember that God will use the attacks in difficult times to refine us. Satan attacks us in the areas of our future victories. If you are being attacked in your body, emotions, relationships, or finances, then I have good news for you. Why would Satan work so hard against you unless you pose a threat to darkness? Now, you have to understand, there's been a whole lot of words that have been going out, and I track with Elijah's list, right? I see that. But man, there's a whole lot of all this great stuff's coming, this happened, this is coming, we're in this and everything, and I'm like, okay, I hope that's right, but I'm just not quite feeling it, right? Heard a lot of that, I'm not quite feeling it. So there was a word from Lance a week and a half ago, that Lance Wall now, sorry, he's one of the guys that I'll track with, Doug Addison, Chuck Pierce, I'll look closely at what Cindy Jacobs says, Dutch Sheets, there's a couple others, but I try, the other folks great, I want to hear some stuff, but I'll pay more attention. As you get through these difficult times, you gain authority in the Spirit, and God will use your suffering to bring repayment and blessings. Are you getting that? Okay, I want you to understand this is that pressure from out along with the fuel within. For a number of years, I've been going through terrible afflictions against my body, emotions, and finances. I've nearly died more than once. God is bringing healing to all these areas of my life. In the past few months, I've gotten healed of Lyme disease, multiple chemical sensitivity, anxiety, and panic attacks, to name a few. Okay, Doug Addison, I think, hears very accurately from God. Okay, good man, noble heart. I love the fact that he's willing to say he's even suffered from panic attacks. A good Christian leader? What? Yes, thank you very much. There's attacks. In the midst of this, I've learned a lot about healing, restoration, and God's love and grace. This is the time that God wants to heal and restore our bodies, emotions, and relationships. This is to position us, say position us, for a coming revival that requires us to have strength and greater authority over the enemy. this is the season to move forward into your life calling like never before. Are you seeing that the stuff that he's been dealing with and the stuff that's gone in is getting him positioned, okay? I want to speak life and hope to all of us who've been dealing with crap. Okay? I mean, it's just sometimes it's just hard. And if you're offended, you can deal with that. I don't care. See, I'm here, so I don't have to deal with all the nee-nee-nee-nee from the other. Okay. Let me keep going. So, burning bush, right? I just want to back up a little bit. I sent the ping out there. I wanted you to read from Exodus 5 and following. I want you to go in there and hang out because you need to bask in this as you're connecting the dots with, as you're moving into what people call Easter, okay? We call it Passover because that's when Jesus was crucified, and Resurrection Sunday, okay? Just because I don't find the name Easter in the Bible anywhere. There's a reason for that, but we won't. I don't care. As long as you celebrate the totality of what Jesus did for you. Not part, but the totality. And what's next? So, how's this for burning bush? You okay with this? Okay, so just a brief thing of the encounter of Moses and the Lord because of this part. Who can read that loud? Phil, you're right there.
Then Moses said, "What if they will not believe me or listen to what I say? For they may say, 'The Lord has not appeared to you.'" The Lord said to him, "What is that in your hand?" And he said, "A staff." Then he said, "Throw it on the ground."
You know what happens next, right? Let's go ahead and just read it. Okay.
So he threw it on the ground, and it became a serpent. And Moses fled from it. But the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand and grasp it by its tail." So he stretched out his hand and caught it, and it became a staff in his hand.
Okay, true story or not? Okay. One of the things that makes it so clearly true is Moses' reaction. Right? How long has this guy been out in the desert? 40 years. In 40 years in the desert, do you know the difference between a poisonous snake and a non-poisonous? Do you know when to run and when not to run? Okay, so what is this telling you if Moses ran? I mean, he's not, right? He's not stupid, right? In 40 years he's been out there. Remember, he was trained in Pharaoh's house. This was a pretty smart guy. I mean, his vision was fine. But what does God tell him to do?
Grab it.
Grab it where? How many of you know how to handle snakes? Okay, where's the last place you want to grab a snake? No, by the tail. You want to grab it just behind the head, right? People can do that and snag them. I mean, there's, by grabbing it by the tail, you're just, okay. Heck, you grab my dog by the tail, you might have something with that. But you grab that snake by the tail. Now, why is that going to be important? Because he was so afraid of it that God put a test to him and said, "You need to grab hold of that which frightens you." Now, here's why. Because he's about to go into Egypt and he's going to confront this guy, right? Pharaoh. Why is that an issue? Well, because the first thing he's going to do, right, is they're going to have the little staff exchange party. My staff can beat up your staff, or in this case, my staff can eat your staff. Why is that critical? Well, lo and behold, look at right there. You know that, right? That was one of the protecting gods over Egypt, one of the master guards. It's why Pharaoh wore it right there. Do you understand now why God would take and have him an experience where he's going to have to deal with the snake by grabbing its tail? He's going to show, you're going to grab another snake's tail. Right? Only it's going to be Pharaoh. And I need to show you beforehand that you can trust me in that, so you can trust me in this. So here's the question. The staff was just something that Moses had for work, right? It represented a tool. It wasn't magic, it was just a staff, right? A walking stick. And it could be used as defense, could be used for a lot of ways. So the question is, I guess, what's in your hand? What do you have for what's next? What do you have? What's the skill set? What are the tools that you have now in your hand? What do you know already? What are the relationships that you have already that's in your hand? I want you to just go home and say, "God, show me what's in my hand." Okay? And then what does he have to do with it, though? What does the Lord say to do with it? throw it down on the ground. You're going to have to set it aside and then see what God does with that. Do you get this? He had to take that. He could have just had a snake come out of the grass and say, okay, now beat it with it. And Moses would have picked up his staff and gone, boo, 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 boo. The reason he ran away is that his tool to whack the snake was the snake. You get that? What he used to use to defend himself now is well, wait a minute, this is kind of creepy. Okay. But God is trying to show him that I can take that which is in your hand and transform it so that later on you understand the authority you have in a different realm. Moses was in the process of being promoted out there. Do you think that was a jolt he went through in this brief encounter with the burning bush? Okay. We know it's a jolt because of the argument that ensues. Go. Nah, I'm not going. Yes, go. Nah. I didn't read the debate, right? Moses is just so, it's like, what are you, nuts? There's a bush burning and not being consumed. Why are you talking back? Okay. You good so far? And when he first goes to Pharaoh and they have the encounter with the staff and he shows him the other signs, right? What happens next? Things really get better, don't they? Moses is a big fan with his people. By the way, before he goes to Pharaoh, you know, he went to his own people and showed him that, right? Along with probably, it's not said, but probably the other sign about the hand that's sick and then whole, and then also pouring out water and it becomes blood, right? Those signs he would have shown to the elders before he ever goes to Pharaoh. And of course, Pharaoh responds really well. So let me, two other questions. Over what do you need authority is the question. As you're getting jolted and sent into, what do you need authority over? What's the religious spirit you need to deal with in a given place, or an intellectual barrier, or the finite? What do you need authority over? You need to go to the Lord and say, Lord, like Moses, I want a staff that can turn so I know that I can deal with the Pharaoh. Are you tracking me? Am I?
Yeah.
Okay. I know it's kind of a metaphor and you're going to have to connect the final dots, is because I can't connect them all for you. That's between you and Jesus. And then here, are you afraid to take it in your hand? There may be something now. Are you afraid to grab hold of it for what it'll do? Well, wait, but what if Moses said, no way, I ain't touching that snake. I don't know how you did that. You can turn it back and then I'll grab it. Right? I'm sorry, that would have been me. Oh, dude, okay. You know that, just reverse that and then we're good. I'll get in then. No, do it now. Yeah, I don't think so. Is this candid camera? Okay. Sorry. What's that? The guy with the magician who does those things on people in the...
Chris Angel.
No, it's a television show. He's regularly doing things. He does it in a store and it's on... Anyway, okay. Never mind. So, Pharaoh responds by saying, fine, showing me that, asking people to go out into the desert. By the way, here's, what's the most famous phrase that is attributed to Moses? What is it again? Okay, there's a problem with that phrase. It's like this, the truth shall make you free. There's a real problem with that phrase because the first part says, you shall know the truth and the truth shall set you free. You have to know, you have to engage it before it has a freedom part to it. Moses does not say, let my people go. He says, let my people go so that they may serve me. Do you understand? There's seven times that's repeated in Scripture. Let my people go so that there's a rest of it, okay? We have the same issue with the church. We think that it's coming to salvation just so that people can get out of jail. And then that's it.
Yep.
Poof. And they're going to show up after they die before the Lord and go, I'm here. And he's going to go, I'm sorry, who are you? Uh-oh. Well, I went to church when I was 12, 13, 20. Okay, but I... What? Let my people go so that they may serve me. Worship me. That same word is translated different ways. So, that's always the encounter with Moses and Pharaoh, but the pressure gets worse. Then as they came out from Pharaoh, they, that was the Israelites, met Moses and Aaron, who stood there to meet them, and they said to them, "Let the Lord look on you and judge, because you have made us abhorrent in the sight of Pharaoh and in the sight of his servants, to put a sword in their hand to kill us." You see the pressure building? Right? This is before any of the plagues start, guys. We haven't even gotten to the plagues. Great deliverer, thanks very much. Go back. Do you understand, though, the frustration at times that people had with Jesus because he wasn't freeing them in the way that they thought the Messiah should? Why don't you just kick ass on these Romans and get them the hell out of Dodge? What is with you? I mean, even John the Baptist has a hard time. Wait a minute, where's your winnowing fork and your fire? I don't get this, right? I proclaimed your, right? You know what I'm talking about. Sure. He's in prison and wondering, are you the one? Are you just not looking quite like the deliverer we thought? The things in our lives now that are going on, the way God's dealing with it, we go, what? God, this is not what I thought. This is not how I thought it was going to work out. What do you mean? Make bricks without straw. What do you mean we're supposed to eat your body and drink your blood? Right? Do you get? All that's building a pressure up because it's different, but it builds up the pressure because God's got a jolt in mind that's going to result in freedom, it's going to result in joy, in a journey, in a joining, and ultimately about coming to a Jordan and crossing into more. Okay, you're getting it, right? So Moses, hey, Lord. So the Lord, Moses returned to the Lord and said, "Lord, why have you brought trouble on this people? Why is it you have sent me? For since I came to Pharaoh to speak in your name, he has done evil to this people. Neither have you delivered your people at all." Any of you feel like Moses lately? Hands? I do, because we've come here and done this work and we've been fighting for freedom and getting more and more freedom, and yet it feels like the stuff just sometimes hits the fan even bigger than it did before. And I go, "Oh Lord, why did you send us here? We're trying to help these folks, and sometimes it seems like it's worse than when we came." What? Yeah. Well, what's that? What's with that? You know, it's just not the way I thought. And you know what? I so get Moses. Let me just quickly snapshot why, right? Born and raised in the church culture, okay? So my dad was a pastor. So I was raised basically in the house, right? Sort of a royal house, if you will, right? Preacher's kids are always kind of weird, but, right? But then I went on and did college, and then I went up and served 3 years in the church and went to seminary and all that stuff. But I was trying to move too much in my own power, so God kicked me out on my butt, and I went into business. I went into the back wilderness, okay? Put into the business world. Thank you very much. It worked a lot better financially and everything else. And then suddenly God slams us down here and puts, it's like, okay, go back. It's like, no. I don't want to, you know. Because, no. Because you were talking about reformation, Gail, that word. Moses was sent to break the people free from a government that used to be aligned with Israel, right? When Joseph was in the house and worked for the people's good, but now came against them. Jesus came in to deal with a nation and with a government, not the Roman government, that had become corrupted over time and now didn't fight for people's freedom but put them under bondage. I'm sorry that it's that same mandate that's somehow in me. I get frustrated because a lot of the institutional structures that are out there control. And I'm like, let my people go, says God. But that's why I get this emotion. I get this feeling. I get this passion. You okay with this? Okay. But see, out of that, I need you to see this. The next thing that God's going to say to Moses as he cries this out is about the issue of domain. Here's this thing. Domain name license. You know what a domain name is, like .com. The freedomoutpost.com. We have that, and we have .org and everything, .net. Anyway, domain. But this is where God's going to say, here's the domain of my name. And so he's going to take Moses into a deeper level. And watch this here. He says, "For then the Lord said to Moses, now you shall see what I will do to Pharaoh, For with a strong hand he will let them go, and with a strong hand he will drive them out of his land. And God, Elohim, spoke to Moses and said to him, I am the Lord. Remember last week Debbie was talking about I am Yahweh. But watch this right here. I appeared to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob as God Almighty, El Shaddai, but by my name Yahweh was not known to them. Moses, I know this is hard, but what's going to happen is I'm actually going to take you on a deeper level of intimacy. My people now are going to get my full name. I appeared to their forefathers as El Shaddai. I'm coming to you now and to them as Yahweh. There's a deeper connect. I know this is hard. I know the pressure is building up, but there's more coming. You've got to believe me. There is more. Is that making sense? I have also established my covenant with them to give them the land of Canaan, the land of their pilgrimage, in which they were strangers. And I've also heard the groaning of the children of Israel, whom the Egyptians kept in bondage, and I have remembered my covenant. God has been waiting, and it's been stirring up. You have to understand the Hebrew word here for remember is not like, oh, I forgot. It's like I'm remembering it purposely. I've now turned. I was waiting. It's like having something that's baking in an oven. I mixed it all up. I put it in the oven, and I set the timer, and I've been sitting there watching it, waiting. Ping. It's done. Right? So that's now's the time for me to engage, and I'm going to stir this up in such a way. And so because of that, now he goes into the four I wills. We're not doing a Seder this year, by the way. We're going to do kind of a mini thing here on Monday night, the 10th of April, which is when Passover happens. But part of it is when we do a Seder, it takes several hours because there's so many parts to it, you get a bit overwhelmed, right? Yeah. And so instead, I'm going to be teaching you parts about it all the way through. So we're going to have some real worship and celebration, and we'll tie in key parts of that, but we're going to try to get it so that it imprints deeply to you in the meanwhile. So these are the I wills. Therefore, say to the children of Israel, I am the Lord, Yahweh, right? His name is out there. The timing of Debbie releasing that word last week is just what God has arranged. And here are the four I wills. I will bring you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. I will rescue you from their bondage. I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and great judgments. I will take you as my people. Amen. This is where he's claiming them as his people. And I will be your God. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God who brings you out from under the burdens of the Egyptians. I will bring you into the land which I swore to give to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and I will give it to you as a heritage. I am the Lord. And because of this, when we do the Passover Seder, there are actually four glasses of wine that are drunk that night. Y'all wonder why the disciples fell asleep afterwards, right? Because there were four glasses of wine. Now, Jesus didn't drink the last one, but we've gone through these, and we're going to cover these over the next three sessions that we're together, plus that last one is the fourth. So we have four times total, three, and then Passover night that night. And so we're on the one now, the first cup, a cup of sanctification. I will bring you out. To sanctify is to say, I've set you apart. I've designated that you are going to be brought separately out. But in order to do that, things have got to be differentiated. And just to tie it in, am I talking too fast? I'm trying to get through. Okay. John 15, as it is, you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. And so we were set apart as a special people. Again, Passover then, Passover with Jesus, Passover now. What are we being separated? So the process by which he brought them out has to do with the plagues, which means to strike down. And so you know these, right? Water to blood, the frogs and the lice. By the way, something I read from a young guy, it makes sense. We think of them as 10 plagues. There's actually three sets of three plus the final judgment. And I think he's right. And they're geared. It's very interesting because the first two always come with pre-warning from Moses, and the third one happens without warning. God doesn't give Pharaoh the heads up. And it happens three times. Second time, flies, disease, livestock, boils. Third, thunderstorm, locusts, and darkness. And then finally, death of the firstborn. This is the one that's finally reserved out that God's going to strike down to the core. And this one young commentator said, what's really happening is God's first going after their wealth, then their health, and finally their faith. Interesting, because it's often how the enemy will go after us. First your wealth, then your health, and then your faith. Right? Okay. We're not going to spend I've done teaching where we do some more about the plagues, and that all of those being specifically targeted against Egypt's gods and Israel's dependencies. Because after 430 years of being baked in with hundreds of gods, it so affected their ability. Okay, I can tell I need to keep going. Round 1, 2, and 3. So it's a match. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Go to Pharaoh, for I had hardened his hearts and the hearts of his officials, so that I may perform these miraculous signs of mine among them, and you may tell your children and grandchildren how I dealt with the Egyptians and how I performed my signs among them, and that you may know that I am Yahweh." So God is specifically hold back bar. Remember the hold back bar? God's got the hold back bar in place there while the pressure underneath builds and builds and builds and builds. Because he's got to make sure they don't just walk out, they are flung out. Okay? So, real quickly, on that same night I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn, both men and angels, and I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. So the process here, right, was one by which God was going to deal with the false structures that were around Israel. So here's the question. God was doing that with Jesus. Do you understand that Jesus comes in and clears out the temple right before? Do you see all the stuff that's building? Do you understand the pressure that was there? Read in John 11 where Lazarus is raised from the dead, and it says after that they made a decision to kill Jesus and to kill Lazarus as well. The pressure is building because he's challenging the structures. He has challenged the structure of death and mourning right in the Jewish culture right there. He's challenging the way that they were having temple there with all the trading and the bartering going on. Challenging, 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 challenging. The pressure is just building up and building up and building up. All those things were assaults against the structures that needed to happen before Jesus actually goes through his Passover and comes out as the first fruit offering. So the question is this: what is God doing in around you now to break down and break off those old structures? What's he beating the crap out of? Your dependence on A, B, C, or D. Just, do you understand there's a process here by which he's saying, you need to see me come against that stuff because I need to break it down because you've been around it too long, you're best in it too long. The reform has to take place. And if you're too stuck in with that stuff, you can't be a reformer because you're going to be too afraid of offending anyone or anything. Okay, so I want to keep rolling here. He's talking about Pharaoh. "For this purpose I have raised you up," this is God is speaking to Pharaoh, "that I might show your my power in you and my name may be declared in all the earth." This is God to Pharaoh. "As of yet you exalt yourself against my people and that you will not let them go." God is dealing and Jesus is dealing, right? I and the Father are one. And they picked up stones. All this stuff, all that pressure building up. So as Jesus is moving in the exact time leading to Passover, that pressure is coming as well. I believe we're in a time now. Passover, trust me, is a significant time. That which was set in place in the dark part of the year, when we crossed into the new year and it's dark, it's just like tonight. Our new night officially on our clock will start at 12:01, right? There's things that are set in place, you're resting, you have no idea what's going on in the rest of the world, and you wake up, and guess what? You can turn on the news, and there's all sorts of stuff that's been developing overnight that you had no clue about. You get that? It's just how time works. God works in the same way. We crossed into the year of the sword, 5777, but now it's been building, building, building. When we cross into Passover, we cross into the fullness of what that next thing is. So, purpose of the present pressure. Deal with the old structures around your life. If we can agree to let God deal by the pressure we're feeling and not fight him or be so ticked off or everything else, but go, God, deal with it. I'm in agreement with you, whatever you're going to bring. You remember, right, the first three plagues, all of Israel experiences those as well. Their water turned to blood. Those frogs were all over the place. They stank to high heaven. Oh, great, Moses, this is thanks very much. Some deliverer you are. And me, I don't like frog legs, so you know, what am I supposed to do? There's so much detail in all of that. They go through the first three, but then God divides and separates out, but the pressure is still building. Leverage the very things set against you to propel you into your purpose. And this is also the purpose, is to demonstrate to you and to all that there's God's power, glory, and plan. And finally, you get those old structures out of your heart so you won't return to them. God was trying desperately to do that with Israel so they would just see and go, you know what, we can't come back here. This is dead to us. Clearly, you needed to keep them baking in there maybe a couple more years. Okay, so, feeling versus reality. Anybody feel like this? We are hard-pressed on every side. We are crushed. We are not perplexed. We are not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not forsaken, struck down, but not destroyed, carrying about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life, life. There's always the other thing. The pressure, the problem, the intensity, the jolt, the being thrown back is also that there is life. Serve Him, worship Him, be with Him. We carry that about so that the life may be manifest in our body. So this is why God was so determined, and He says He will let you go from here, and when He does, He will drive you out completely. You see this plane taking off? Do you have any idea of the thrill that has to be? I'm sure there's some terror in it, but there's just like a, right? Landing's a whole other issue, right? But taking off is just like whoosh. How many of you have flown in a small plane? Okay, it's both terrifying and cool, right? Mm-hmm. I've even flown in a glider a few times where there's no engine at all. Got up there with my uncle, was up there for hours. He was one time up for 12 hours on the currents. Got up and just banked and, but let me show you this, because I put this in the email, and God is in a good mood, because in the midst of all this pressure building and you're going like, oh, what's going on? The frogs stink and this is happening and I have to make bricks without straw. And God's in a good mood because He knows the plan that He's working in your life right now. Because He knows to whom you belong, and that's Him. And He said to the universe, that one's mine. So yeah, there can be a lot of garbage happening around them, but that one's mine. I have a plan for them. He's in a good mood because you being squirrely is sometimes just sort of funny. Because He goes, why is she doing that? Why is he? Does he really think he needs to be that loud for me to hear him? Give me a break. Yeah. You really think he's got to do that to earn my goodwill? I love him. Why don't he just chill out, right? You think God's not at times going like, can you believe this? Can you think the angels don't get some chuckles? Because they know who you are. They know where you're going. They know the destiny. This is like the royal servants watching over the young little five-year-old prince who's sitting there and drooling on the carpet. And the servants are like, okay, well, that's pretty funny. Yes, Your Highness, it's okay. You'll be fine. He's in a good will because He knows how this is going to work out for your good and His glory. Amen. And finally, He's in a good mood because He knows He's God and you're not. Okay, just remember the I wills. There's a fourfold and it still works today. So the questions you're going to have is, Lord, show me what my staff is. What do I have in my hand? How do I lay it down? What are you doing with it? Where do I need to grab it by the tail? So I have the authority, and I know I have the authority when I got to go before the real serpent. Right? Yes. How can I agree with you for this building up of the pressure? That plane has to go to full throttle at the right time. If it's not, like I said, that catapult will just break part of it apart. God is working to build circumstances to get you to a launch point. You have to agree with Him, stay in His timing, and then out of that, jolt. Joy, journey, join, and another Jordan. And then it'll happen again. But that's the leave, cleave, become one. Leave, cleave, become one. And you enter into a new stage. Father, I just seal this word now that whatever was of you, which might have been only a couple bits, but Lord, let that part remain and just blow everything else out and up. Lord, thank you for the freedom you've given us in Jesus. But thank you that it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Therefore, we will not submit again to a yoke of slavery. Lord, break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain. So that the life of Jesus, so that serving you, so that moving with you into the next adventure is what we do. We pray this and seal it now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.